Well, I'm just so pleased to welcome you to these highlights of our conference call with Congressman Barney Frank. Barney is, of course, the chairman of the Financial Services Committee in the House. He was the leader in getting the financial reform bill passed, the most important bill, as some have said, in financial reform since the New Deal. And he is not so incidentally my brother. So I'm very proud of Barney and his leadership. And I'm very pleased that we're able to present this conversation with Barney Frank for our members. I hope you'll listen to these highlights. And then if you like what you hear and you'd like to hear more, come in, come on in, join us as a member of No Limits. You get to hear the full conversation with Congressman Barney Frank. You can hear our previous conversation with Senator Barbara Mikulski, who talked about the Mikulski Amendment, so important for women's health that she has included in the health reform bill, and we'll have many more conversations to come.
That with our ingenuity, creativity, and innovative spirit, there are no limits to what is possible in America.
Bad loans were made, and then they were sold around the world, and people were then able to insure against them going bad. I mean, that was AIG got in trouble because they were issuing insurance policies that they didn't have the money to pay off against mortgage-backed securities. And people said, well, how could you possibly, you know, issue insurance without being able to pay it off? And the answer is, they thought, a lot of people thought, that house prices could never go down, so that if you were insuring mortgage-backed securities, you would never have to pay off. I've said the analogy is like people selling life insurance policies on vampires. If you sold the life insurance policy on a vampire, you would assume never to pay off. Then the vampires died, and there were some problems. But we stopped the bad loans from being made. Then we stopped people from selling them without retaining some, which helps them not want to make bad loans. But then we say, if you're a financial institution, you cannot start investing in these things without showing us that you've got the ability to pay off. So if you take an AIG, and then finally we say, and if, by the way, if all else fails, and you do fail, we will put you out of business. There won't be an AIG where you'll get your creditors paid off and you'll keep going. You'll be put out of business, and other financial institutions will be taxed to pay for the expenses of that.
Wow. Perfect. I'm still back on the life expectancy of vampires, and I suspect I'm not the only one on the call who's going to walk away with that image. Let me move on to the question of mortgages and home buying. And this comes in two categories. We get questions about, does the bill make it safer for people to buy new homes by addressing predatory lending and exorbitant interest rates, but also a little bit for people who are still in trouble? What about people who are in danger of losing their homes because of the mortgage payments?
Let me answer the easy one. Yes, this bill puts laws in place that will protect people from bad mortgages. And we even give them incentive to have even better mortgages. I didn't want to mandate that they give this or that product because that doesn't work. But under the risk retention I talked about, if you're selling a mortgage, you'll have to hold 5% of that. I mean, if you're trying to securitize it. But if you offer a 30-year fixed-rate mortgage with a decent down payment and a reasonable interest rate, you might be able to sell the whole thing. So we give them an incentive to do the safe mortgages, and we outlaw the bad mortgages. No more 2.28, where it's a low rate for 2 years and up for 28. And frankly, we protect people against bad mortgages, but we restrain people from being abusive themselves by lying about their income. And that will be enforced by the consumer agency. So, yes, you will not see the bad mortgages, because the bad mortgages didn't just hurt individuals. They hurt the whole system.
Jenny Blackton of California has sent in a question I think a number of people have puzzled about TARP. There are conflicting reports out there. Has TARP, and I think as you told us, this really was a Bush-era program, but has the TARP money been repaid or not?
Mostly it has. By the way, two very good economists, Mark Zandi, who was an advisor to John McCain, he's a very decent and artfully honest guy, and Alan Blinder, the former vice chair of the Federal Reserve, just did a study saying that the collective efforts of Congress and the administration of the Federal Reserve under Obama, the economic recovery bill and the TARP and the other things, have done an enormous amount of good for the economy. They haven't brought it to where it was, but they talk about how much worse off things would be if we didn't have them. As to the TARP, there were three chunks of TARP money. Money that was lent to banks, most of it has been repaid. It was a total of $240 billion. Most of it has been repaid, and the amounts that have been repaid so far from the institutions that got it would make the profit. The TARP money lent to banks will be fully repaid within a few months at a profit of about 10%. The money lent to AIG, or given to AIG, which initially was done just by the Bush people, was still uncertain about that. And the president now said yesterday that he believes that the money that went to Chrysler and GM will also be repaid. So of the $700 billion figure originally authorized, given what happens at AIG, it may be that $50 billion in the end won't be repaid. But the money sent to the banks is already being repaid. So we may lose some money on AIG and Chrysler. But under the bill, by the way, there was then a mandate that if any money is not repaid fully, the financial community has to be taxed to pay for it. So worst case, there'll be a less than $50 billion loss, and it may break even. I do now, the second vote is on. I have like 2 minutes, so I'm going to have to go vote.
All right. Let me, 1 minute. Anything that we can look forward to Congress achieving in the next, in this fall? You've given us a lot about what the obstacles are.
Well, it depends on the Senate. I hope there'll be some good legislation on the oil spills. That's very important. And Senator Reid is trying to get something done that will deal with at least that part of energy and increase the renewables issue. And I hope we will take a position that will allow tax cuts to continue for people making below $150,000, but will not allow tax cuts to go into effect for people making more. And, you know, this debate goes on. We have to remember what President Clinton got us to do in 1993. We raised taxes with President Clinton, the Democrats in Congress, from 36% to 39% marginal income above $150,000. Now we're up to $200,000. All the right-wing predictions were this would tank the economy. Instead, in the years after that tax cut, we had the best economic period in American history. So I hope we will allow, if we're serious about fighting the deficit, not hypocritical about just using that as a way to block environmental or other kinds of programs, that will allow tax rates to go back up to where they were during those great economic years under President Clinton for higher incomes.
Thank you so much. I know you've got a vote. I know everybody on the call is so grateful for this. Thank you all. Barney,
okay,
you go vote.
I'll talk to you later.
And let me thank you. We will talk.